I think there is a fixed concept about this whole idea of meditating that we have to be sitting down and we have to practice a certain concept. But for some people, running could be their form of meditation. Working out could be their form of meditation. And to me, you seem like, and I follow your Instagram stories, you're always working out at 4 a.m. You're super motivated. That's something about you that is super clear that I think stands out amongst, and I know a lot of motivated people, but there's something about you, your energy, even when I'm sitting across from you, there is this, you have this drive, this tinkling in your eye that's still there, I feel. And generally the people that have these big inspirations or motivations, they generally come from the worst place, right? Whether it's poverty, whether it's, you know, tragic death. You know, for me, I'm an immigrant. So I came here when I was 7 and, you know, my parents had to fight for everything. And for me, this is everything that I do is for me to give back to what they've given me. I'm curious to know what that is for you.
So I think in movies, and by the way, thank you for the Matrix code behind us, which is for sure the most impactful movie on my life. But let's talk about Star Wars for a second. And they do a really good job of showing both the light side and the dark side. And I think people need both. And I think that there are evolutionary mechanisms that are there. The light side makes you feel connected. It makes you want to help. It makes you really want to contribute to the tribe. And I think it's pretty obvious why that would be advantageous for such a social creature, to want to do good things for people, to want to see them win, to think about the beautiful things that you want to create in your life. That I think makes sense to people. But what I think people miss is the power of the dark side. Now, I live in an 80-20 split between what I call beauty and rage. So 80% of my time, I'm in the beautiful, the good relationships, the positive things I want to create, the wonderful things that are already going right, the things I'm grateful for, my compelling vision of my future, which I think will bring a lot of good to a lot of people. But then I spend 20% of the time in rage, in self-hatred, in being fundamentally disappointed with who I am today and what I've accomplished, in knowing how much more I could do, in focusing on the enemies who want to see me destroyed, the people that actively want me to fail. And in that, and so I'll come back to, from an evolutionary standpoint, that anger, that rage is nature's way of allowing you to be able to withstand a higher degree of pain and suffering. So if you take, they've done controlled studies of this, absolutely fascinating. So if you take somebody and you want to see how much pain they can tolerate, what they do is they make you submerge your arm in ice bucket. So it's actually worse, like ice water. So you've got your arm in there and at first everybody's fine. You don't have to do anything. But then after like 3, 6, 10 minutes, it's brutal. And it really begins to be this mental torture where it's like, how long can I endure this? Because they know I can pull my arm out at any time. So how do I manage to keep going through this? And what they found is if they told people, right when you feel like you have to pull it out, I want you to get angry and start swearing. And when they do that, they can stay for 30% longer by triggering an anger response, by being aggressive, by really like enraging themselves. So you can imagine if you encounter an animal, a warring tribe, like whatever, and you need to show up at that moment. It isn't thinking the beautiful thoughts. It's fucking bloodthirst, man. It is like, I am not going to lose. I'm going to rage into this person. I'm going to go with everything I have. And in that, that adrenaline, that aggression, that like anger and rage, you're able to deal with what you're actually in the middle of, which is going to be high degree of pain, which obviously is going to be suffering. So it is a tool that we've been given that lets us really push. Now, it's when people lose the balance and they spend north of, in my opinion, north of 20% in that, it begins to be corrosive. So if you're spending north of 20% of your time focused on the people who hate you, focused on how disappointed you are with your own results, focused on you know, how hard things are, if you spend more than 20% of your time there, it begins to diminish you. And that's where people just have to realize it's a choice. Right? You get what you focus on. So if you focus on the bad things, they're going to be there and they will seem ever present. But likewise, if you focus on the good things, they will be there and they will seem ever present. So you get to decide how, what percentage of your time. You could spend no time in the darkness, and there are people that do that, right? You could spend all of your time in the darkness, and unfortunately, there are people who do that. But I think at the end of the day, it's really about understanding what the power each one of those has, knowing when to use them, and knowing what the appropriate balance is to really be centered, to really still feel the joy in your life. And I think that most of the time, you're better off focusing on the beauty and spending your time there on something that's uplifting and encouraging and motivating and inspiring. But 20% of the time, I promise, that will fail you.
How do you trigger that? What are the things you think about? What are the specific processes that you go through? Because I think it's a hard mindset shift when either on opposite ends, right? Whether you're feeling miserable, it's hard for most people to trigger happiness from a snap of a finger. And it's also, I think, natural for us not to want to go to that darkness if they don't see it as a tool. But I'm curious to know how you get into that state.
Here's something that's really, really fascinating, and it's called a negative feedback loop. So you have positive feedback loops, like labor. Labor is a positive feedback loop. So once a woman goes into labor, as one chemical raises, the next chemical raises, and that chemical B raising triggers chemical A to raise higher, chemical A raising higher triggers chemical B, and that's why once labor starts, you can't stop it. So it's not like they ever go, you know what, nah, let's hold this off for a couple of days. It doesn't happen. Like, it's a one-way train. Negative feedback loops, there's mechanisms to stop them. So you have you have an antagonist and a whatever the other one is. It's not protagonist. Oh, okay. That's in like a story, but it's and it's not antagonist either. Anyway, the two things that work together. So as one goes up, the other one necessarily goes down. So take the sympathetic nervous system, which is fight or flight, and the parasympathetic nervous system, which is rest and digest. So fight or flight, you know, we're about to get into something, boom, your cortisol levels spike, your heart rate goes up, you start breathing more rapidly, your muscles are mobilized, they are ready to run or engage. Conversely, when you meditate, you're slowing your breathing, you're slowing your heart rate, you're lowering your cortisol levels. So you can't do both at the same time. So this is why meditation is so effective, as you raise your parasympathetic nervous system, your heart rate's coming down, your breathing's going more shallow, the sympathetic nervous system, the fight or flight, is coming down. And that's why you feel this like sense of well-being as you begin to meditate. So that's your negative. Now, the body has mechanisms worked into it to allow you to trigger these things. So for instance, if you want to immediately get into a happy place, start it from the body. If you're not feeling it, start it from the body. They've done studies on this, absolutely incredible. If you have somebody rate their level of happiness, they'll rate it one way. If you have somebody rate their level of happiness holding a pencil in their teeth, which sort of forces their face into a smile, they'll rate their levels of happiness higher just from holding the pencil consistently. Wow. Now, the reason is something called mirror neurons. If you know V.S. Ramachandran, who's actually been a guest on Impact Theory, an amazing human being and one of the most extraordinary neuroscientists ever. This guy's just unbelievable. But he's done a lot of work into mirror neurons. Now, mirror neurons, if you've ever heard about mirroring and matching, which is something in NLP, where it's like when you're talking to somebody, you and I will both start nodding at the same time, right? To connect with each other, if I fold my arms, you're likely to fold yours. You lean in, I'll lean in. So that's mirror neurons at work. Now, mirror neurons are what allow, especially like kids, to see something and learn how to do it. But it lets anyone match the facial features that the other person is doing to actually feel what they're going through. So if you put a camera on the audience while they watch a movie, you can actually see them. They're like mimicking the facial expressions of the people on screen, which is one of the reasons you really feel connected. You empathize with them because we have this mechanism where when we hold our face in a certain way, it actually makes us feel a certain way. So the next time you're in a piss poor mood and you really want to cheer yourself up, force yourself. You're going to feel stupid, but force yourself to laugh out loud. You can't stay angry. You can't. It's that, what I'll call tagonist and antagonist. It's not called that. I know that. I just can't remember
the
word.
We'll look it up.
Yeah. So it's that balance between those two things, right? When you start laughing out loud, it forces the change in neurochemistry that's going to dissipate whatever you were feeling, what was making you angry, anxious, whatever. Like, that will go down. So conversely, if I really wanted to trigger the rage, the anger, not only am I going to force myself to think about something that enrages me, but I'm also going to furrow my brow. I'm going to take a more aggressive stance. I'm actually going to flex my muscles. Like, doing things like that make you feel like literally just doing that now, lowering my forehead, bringing my brow down, flexing my muscles, gritting my jaw, like it makes me feel aggressive, right? Mm. So you can very rapidly, once you understand how the body and mind work together and how they are inextricably linked and how doing something to the body will immediately impact the mind, which is why I begin my days with working out, even though I hate working out. Once you begin to understand that reciprocal relationship, you can do extraordinary things.